Carson Craning. I'm back. It's been a while. It's been a good while. Just been focusing on school and work for a while, but now we're back doing this and I'm pretty excited. And let's just hop in. When it comes to modern archive fashion, one of the brands that gets brought up again and again and again is Helmut Lang. And I feel like a lot of people don't really understand Helmut or his work. They just know him for the jeans or, you know, the parkas or whatever else is they have seen on these archive websites. And I want to explore the brand a little bit today and just kind of talk about it and give you guys a basic, better understanding of why Helmut Lang is so important and why over and over again people talk about his clothes and his collections. So to dive into Helmut Lang, one thing you really have to understand first is who he is as a person. And as a person, Helmut was born in rural Austria, and in his early teens he moved to Vienna, the capital of Austria, I believe. When he moved to Vienna, it was quite a culture shock for him as he grew up in this rural areas, and he became really inspired by what people were wearing and he thought it was really cool. And of course the fashion in Vienna wasn't anything too crazy necessarily. But it was just a lot of old repurposed military wear as well as leather jackets. And these two things really affected Helmut and what he thought was cool. And so this brings us to our first point of Helmut Lang, is that he was a minimalist. Now what Helmut being a minimalist means is that his work isn't necessarily very crazy or avant-garde or out there, or it's not necessarily very glamorous either. But what it is still very cool, as it's more basic, regular, kind of everyday clothing, but the devil is in the details, and that's what really makes the clothes. Another great example of a minimalist would be Jill Sanders or Anne Mille Meester. And so it's this kind of philosophy that Helmut formed when he first came to Vienna, of seeing all these cool military-inspired looks as well as leather jackets, is making clothes like that that aren't necessarily extremely out there or avant-garde, but are very cool in the way that he modifies and plays with those garments. Now in Vienna, Helmut graduated school. After graduating school, he decided to become a bartender and then became involved with the local art scene and was trying to be an aspiring artist in Vienna. As he was being an artist, he started making his own clothes, whether it be a pair of jeans or a t-shirt. And eventually his friends started to notice how good he was at making these clothes, and they started supporting him, and eventually it kept on growing. He kept on making clothes, meeting with tailors, and just kind of starting to put his feet in the water. Though clothes weren't a priority for him, it was a way where he thought he could express himself a little bit, not as much as traditional art, but in a way he thought was cool. And eventually that began to rise. He began to open his own boutique, and the brand of Helmut Lang began to grow into what it is today, or at least in the 90s. Now, when Helmut Lang first really began to take off, it was in the 90s, and in the 90s, for context, there wasn't a lot going on in fashion that was that crazy or out there. It was a lot of couture, kind of snobby, think of like Dior, Gucci. So in a way, when Helmut came onto the scene, he was very anti-fashion. And the closest thing to him were his predecessors before him, of Rei Kawakubo and Yohji Yamamoto, who both were the first to kind of dive into avant-garde. Though their work is nothing like Helmut's, but it still has that anti-fashion personality. And in the 90s, it was really Helmut Lang and Mason Margiela who took clothing to a different level of not having to be this couture and having all these crazy glitzy designs, but rather, as Bliss Foster said in his other video, making fashion cool. It's because of Helmut Lang that in the 90s that jeans can be considered art, and fashion doesn't have to just be like dresses and formal wear, but instead also t-shirts, parkas, denim. And because of this, Helmut Lang laid the foundation for modern menswear and streetwear. Before him, pieces of clothing had to be couture to be considered art, and he was the first to really break that mold and bring kind of minimalism and everyday clothes into this world of art and fashion. What Helmut was doing in many ways was giving the consumer something that they could wear every day and incorporate into their wardrobe with an artist twist. Some of the best examples of this include his denim, which include the very now memed on painter denim, which was really genius because not only did Helmut use rubber-based paint so the paint wouldn't wear and wash out of the denim after a couple of wears, but it was one of the first examples of distressing in clothes and giving this blue collar look and making it cool. Then also on denim, there's the tape paint denim in which you would draw these lines on it, again with this rubber-based paint. And it wouldn't be something you would notice upon first seeing it, but after the second glance you would see it, and it's just these little unique details that make it look really cool, where you would paint these rectangular blocks on the denim in different places to give it a little bit more personality and character. And because of that, it was something that made Helmut's denim just a little bit more special, and so it could be that one piece that people really cherished in their wardrobe. Also with these Helmut Lang painted on jackets and jeans, see these patterns of like the horizontal lines, and this is most likely where Virgil Abloh stole his idea for the iconic off-white pieces with the lines on them, as well as this other Margiela jacket that most likely those two combined inspired him to make most of the off-white pieces. So thanks a lot, Virgil. So Helmut was giving the consumer something that was very normal and everyday, but also just had these little special details that made it really cool, and people wanted to buy them because of it, and it was so different from everything else that other houses were offering at the time. It was refreshing in the 90s to have these components that you could take for your wardrobe that were just like everything else, but in many ways not like everything else. They had these little special details that just made them really cool. However, with Helmut, not everything he was doing was extremely minimalist. A lot of his pieces were a little bit more out there and different and really could catch your eye. A good example of this, I think, would be the Astro Parkas, which were these parkas that Helmut released in several variants, some which were more, the colors were more muted and gave off more of a military vibe, and others which were much more standout, which had this silver color variant that kind of made it look like it was an early space suit of some sort. And this brings us to another motif in Helmut's work of taking an everyday object that you would wear every day and bringing in elements from different uniforms and professions and kind of bringing them together. So for Helmut, growing up in rural Austria, a parka would be something that would be very necessary and you would wear every day in the winter. And then by bringing in the more muted colorways, the kind of military or even goth elements, and in the silver colorways, bringing in this astronaut kind of space vibe, shows how Helmut would continuously bring in these motifs of certain professions like an astronaut or the military and kind of combine them in his own way with everyday clothes to kind of make this really cool wardrobe where you have the best pieces of his favorite uniforms that he loved that inspired him. Another example of Helmut taking elements from different cultures and professions and bringing it into his own kind of melting pot of a wardrobe collection that he was offering people would be the bondage elements, which show up again and again in Helmut's work. And This could have been taken from the club culture he was involved with in Vienna, as he was well known to be a bartender and in the art scene, so he definitely could have seen these bondage elements, as well as there's the sequins parka, or all the bras, which definitely are influenced and have this relationship with club culture. However, it's quite likely that the bondage elements aren't taken from that culture, but instead more taken from medical or orthopedic and military design and uniforms. I'm basing this assumption off of a 2001 interview I found with the magazine after his 2001 collection that had many bondage elements, where he said, "But afterwards, the show, everyone called it bondage, and I'm like, bondage? Question mark." So this is, of course, implying that perhaps those elements which we call today bondage and have this look of bondage aren't actually associated with bondage and club culture, but rather more likely is orthopedic garments as well as medical garments, or can even often serve a utilitarian purpose. For example, the straps may be used to alter the shape of the garment when you pull on them. Or for example, the coats which have these bondage straps on the inside that kind of turn them into backpacks, that may be a more utilitarian thing than a bondage thing. So while it is controversial of me to say that the bondage elements aren't really bondage but more medical and military inspired, I think there's definitely some basis for it. And I think you guys can talk about in the comments whether you think I'm right or wrong. But there are definitely a lot more military-inspired garments in his collections, such as him using Kevlar for jackets, as well as the bulletproof vests he used. This is another example of another motif that shows up in Helmut's work, of mixing materials in unconventional ways. For example, he used leather, iridescent fabrics, sheer, latex, metallic fabrics, metallic inserts, and a whole bunch of other different materials in ways in which they weren't traditionally used in fashion. And this was really revolutionary in a way. It showed how Helmut thought outside the box and took garments that we thought were exclusively one material and brought them and mixed them with these other materials and brought them to a new level. A good example of this would be his denim jackets, which had leather sleeves, as well as his Kevlar-inspired gear. And these unconventional, revolutionary ideas really influenced the whole menswear and womenswear scene as we know it today. If it wasn't for Helmut, he was certainly one of the most influential figures with this. And if he didn't just influence fashion as a whole, he definitely influenced one of his employees who worked with him for some time, Carol Christian Powell, who we talked about in the last video, who was also really influenced by Helmut's creativity to use unconventional materials. And that's a motif that carried on into Carol's work that he gained in experience from his time with Helmut. But what does this all exactly mean? Why does this make Helmut's work important? Well, in the 90s, Helmut was reshaping what fashion was and what it is today. It was because of him and Margiela, in many ways, that fashion was able to leap out of all this just tailoring and dresses and formal wear, and was able to make this leap into jeans and t-shirts and jackets. All were able to be considered art. He was making what seemed basic to most people in the fashion community very interesting and very cool. He was making clothes for people who were motivated but also artistic and almost punk, and almost had this rebellious edge to his clothing. He was the first designer who was giving people a full wardrobe that they could wear every day that was cool. With this, he was really the father of streetwear in many ways, as he was giving people the first taste of clothes that would be for the street and to wear anywhere on any occasion almost. And his clothes made his way from the street to the corporate world with his very iconic tailoring and cuts that defined a decade, as well as being somewhat rebellious and youthful in spirit. He made clothes for young people that were bold yet appropriate and very cool. It's Helmut's balance of boldness and wearability that took him to where he is one of the most iconic names in menswear and fashion today. Helmut Lang was the one who set the stage for designers like Raf Simons, Jun Takahashi, and many others to just make clothes that they wanted to and they felt inspired by. And without Helmut, we wouldn't have menswear as we know it today. We still might be in this dark age of just having to see different tailored suits again and again. And there's nothing wrong with good tailoring. I'm a huge fan of Tom Ford, for example, as well as Comme des Garçons en plus. But it's cool to see designs outside of that that you can wear every day on the street or at your house or at a party. And Helmut was the one who set the stage for that. And because of his ingenuity and creativity and ability to think outside the box with his designs, it really allowed other designers to be okay with thinking outside the box without a fear of being ostracized. And that's why he's really important, and I've come to love and cherish his work the more I have gone on. Helmut eventually sold and left the brand in 2004, but his influence can still be seen today in just about any menswear collection that isn't just tailoring and suits. And that's what makes Helmut so awesome, is that he was responsible for all of that.
I forced the fear to love.